Still recording. Welcome everyone. So we will talk about water electrolyte imbalance, and we will talk about the reproductive male system. Okay, so the importance of water. You know, everybody knows that the water is going to be required for metabolic reactions, right? Metabolic reactions, all the chemical reactions that happen in your body are going to be basically happening in water. One of the first sign of dehydration or patient needs water is mechanism of thirst. So they are going to become thirsty. So if you see a patient who is thirsty, that means that probably is having low levels of, water is going to be low. So you can check, for example, the urinary output. The urinary output is going to be, should be more than 30 mLs per hour. That is always coming. It's very important to know that. But other hormones that are going to participate is going to be the ADH, the antidiuretic hormone, and we have the aldosterone. So I'm going to cut the cross caption. Oh, okay. And we have buffers. Buffers are going to be, for example, the bicarbonate, very important. We will have the hemoglobin, yeah, and other proteins. Kidney function regulation of the pH, you know that the kidneys is having a function called the secretion, that is the one who regulate the excretion or more or less excretion of hydrogens and bicarbonate. Depends how your acid-base state is in your body. Many questions here, I want to go here, is the intra and the extracellular is a fluid. The intracellular fluid, we are going to have the potassium and the phosphate. We are going to have in the extracellular, the sodium and the chloride. So please, open eyes, open ears. You're going to see this very soon. I want all the levels of sodium. I want the levels of potassium. I need to know the levels of, let's see, pH. Let's see the levels of bicarbonate, carbon dioxide, and what else? And calcium. Sodium is 135 to 145. Potassium 3.5 to 5. pH 3.5 to 7. No, sorry, 735 to 745. Bicarbonate is 22 up to 26, carbon dioxide 35 to 45, and calcium will be between 8.5 and 10. So those are 1, 2, 3, 6 values you must remember, please, okay? So another thing I want you to remember is this, the major intracellular cation and anion. So please, you need to memorize in order to know the answer, to know the what to answer. You need to know the potassium is positive 1, sodium is positive 1, phosphate negative 1, chloride is negative 1, magnesium is positive 2, calcium is positive 2. Okay, and which one are most important in the extra, in the intracellular, right? So first of all, you need to remember that salt. What is salt? Salt is sodium chloride, right? Sodium chloride, sodium chloride, sodium chloride. How to remember that? First of all, it is negative and the sodium is positive, right? So that's why they're coming together. So if you have, just to remember, you have a salt pepper around your this is the salt. You have your dish here. This is your dish, your plate, where your food, whatever, your chicken or whatever it is. And the salt is out of the plate, correct? This is salt. Salt. What is salt? Sodium chloride. Out of the plate. So this is the extracellular and this is the intracellular. Just to remember, salt, always put it outside your plate, okay? All right, so here we have the cations and anions. We have the ADH that produces the posterior pituitary gland by the pituitary gland. So we are talking about electrolyte balance. Electrolyte balance is going to be all the elements that we was talking, sodium, potassium, chloride, calcium, etc. So, and this calcitonin participate in that calcium metabolism. Parathyroid gland, parathyroid hormone in the calcium calcium metabolism. Antidiuretic hormone is going to be water, and reabsorption of the aldosterone basically is going to be sodium and water. Okay? All right, so electrolyte balance are going to be involved aldosterone, the ADH, aldosterone, the LDH, the PTH, and the calcitonin. Okay, the calcitonin. So atrial natriuretic peptide is actually located in the right atrium of the heart. I'm not going to ask that, but when the heart is too distended, too much volume getting into the right atrium, the heart is thinking that it is too much volume, so they are going to start eliminating fluid. All right, so we have the acid-base balance, 735 to 745. So a few things I need to remark because there is many questions coming for acid-base. Number one is the hydrogens. The more hydrogen, the more acid. So that means the pH is lower. So again, so if you have more hydrogens, the acidity is going to be higher, more acid, but the value is going to be lower in the pH. Don't forget that, 0 to 14. 0 is acid and 14 is alkaline, okay? All right, so be careful with this, okay? All right, so just remember, the more acid, the more acid. The more hydrogens, the more acid, right? And the pH is going to be lower, okay? So now there is two organs that are going to be the mechanism of compensation. So for example, remember the formula that we was talking, carbon dioxide plus water equal the carbonic acid equal the hydrogens and the bicarbonate. So this is a very weak alkaline, this is very strong acid. So, all right, so what I want to tell you is this. If you increase the levels of carbon dioxide, there is going to be always a winner, that is the strong hydrogen. The strong hydrogen. If you have your blood, in this case, when you have too much hydrogen, you have acidosis, correct? Acidosis. If you have acidosis, open eyes, open ears, very well, please. What you are trying, how your body is trying to compensate. The body is trying to compensate, first of all, what is the problem? The problem is too much what? Hydrogens, and why is that? Because too much carbon dioxide, right? The carbon dioxide is coming because you have asthma, you cannot breathe, you have sleep apnea, etc. So that is going to increase the levels of hydrogens in your blood. So, but the problem is that who produce the increase of hydrogen in blood is the excess of carbon dioxide. So what is doing the body in order to compensate? If you're going to compensate, you're going to try to get rid of the most amount of carbon dioxide. And how you're doing that? Doing the hyperventilation. Okay, so don't skip this one, okay? Hyperventilation. So you have hyperventilation, you're trying to get rid of more of carbon dioxide. As a consequence, the carbon dioxide is going down. When they go down, you have less strong acids, strong acids, and that's what is going to increase your pH. Okay? Increase your pH. So if you have the problem is what? Problem is acidosis. What is the solution? The body is going to give you hyperventilate. If you hyperventilate, you're going to decrease you're going to decrease the levels of carbon dioxide because you are exhaling all the carbon dioxide you have. You are hyperventilating. If you decrease the carbon dioxide, it's going to decrease the levels of hydrogen. So that is when you have acidosis is going to be hyperventilation. When you have alkalosis, the pain is not helping, is going to be hypoventilation. Okay, so remember that, please, okay? So let's make it again. So what happened if you have acidosis? What is your body, how is your body responding to compensate? It's going to hyperventilate. If you have alkalosis, could be metabolic, whatever you want, alkalosis is going to be the hypoventilation. So in order not to, you get lost. So this is the problem, and this is the solution or partial solution of the body. So what is doing when you have acidosis, you hyperventilate. When you are in alkalosis, you're going to hypoventilate, okay? Okay, so we have the buffers. Buffers are the bicarbonate, the phosphate, and the proteins. We have the hemoglobin, for example, and respiration and kidney. Respiration is going to take a very fast compensation. For example, if the respiration is the problem, the primary problem is the respiration, the kidneys is going to take over. Kidneys means that it's going to compensate. For example, if you have too much acid in your blood, too much acid, okay, what is doing the kidney? The kidney is going to eliminate more hydrogens. If you have more alkaline, if you're more alkaline, if your blood is more alkaline, and the problem is the respiration, who is going to compensate? The kidney. The kidney, what is going to do is to get rid of the bicarbonate. Excess or defect of hydrogens or bicarbonate is going to be taken over by the kidney. The excess or defect of carbon dioxide is going to be taken by the lungs, respiration. So here we have carbon dioxide managed by the lungs and the lungs taking care of the carbon dioxide, and the kidneys are going to take care of the hydrogens and the bicarbonate, okay? So be careful with this. Okay, so one more time. Is the problem, primary problem, is the respiration, who is taking care, is the kidney. If the kidney is the primary problem, who is going to compensate, is the respiration. One more time. If the respiration is the problem, who is going to compensate, the kidney. If the kidney is the problem, who is going to compensate, is the respiration, okay? So please, the values, you remember, we was talking about the ROM. Don't forget that, please, because I'm going to ask you what happened when the pH is high or the carbon dioxide is high. But probably I'm going to tell you the pH is 7.48 and the carbon dioxide is 50. So it's actually the same question, the same answer, right? Because it's high, you need to know the values. If you don't know the values, you start to study now, okay? You need to know all the values that we just mentioned on the previous one. Respiratory means, respiratory, we have your first thing, your eye is going to look the pH. The pH is low or high. Then you decide if this is alkalosis or is this acidosis. And then the next step is to decide if this is metabolic or respiratory. If the pH is going up and the carbon dioxide going down, so it's opposite, right? It's wrong. Respiratory opposite. So that means respiratory problem. And with this pH high, it's alkaline. It's respiratory alkalosis. If you have the pH down, and the pH down and the carbon dioxide is high, so opposite again, respiratory, but the pH is low, so it's acidosis. And please don't make mistake here. The pH is low, it's not alkalosis, it's acidosis, okay? All right, so when you have metabolic is pH CO2, metabolic pH is down, the carbon dioxide is down. So this is acidosis because the pH is low. And it's metabolic, why? Because it's same direction. So metabolic acidosis. This is the opposite. pH going up and the carbon dioxide go up. So that means that you have alkalosis, high pH, and you have high carbon dioxide. So it's metabolic alkalosis. All right, so please, I want you to remember that very well. So you have four options: respiratory acidosis, respiratory alkalosis, metabolic acidosis, metabolic alkalosis. Okay, so remember the values, please. Okay, all right. So let's go to the reproductive system. Okay, one more time. If you are have acidosis, your lungs are going to compensate doing what? Hyperventilation or hypoventilation? Okay, okay, telepathically, you're telling me hyperventilation. If you have alkalosis, you're going to have hypoventilation to compensate. Okay, alkalosis, you have low levels of carbon dioxide, right? So if you are hypoventilating, you're going to retain more carbon dioxide, correct? If you have acidosis, that means that you have too much carbon dioxide, correct? If you have too much carbon dioxide and acidosis, you want to get rid of the carbon dioxide doing that hyperventilation. Simple as that. All right, so let's talk about the reproductive system. And talking about the reproductive system, we have all the main structures, right? So one thing I want you to remark here is, look at this. This is the urinary bladder. This is the urethra. Can you see here, everybody looking? The urethra, okay? The prostatic urethra. This prostatic urethra is going to pass, literally perforating the prostate. This is the prostate. This, and this is the prostate. This prostate is going to be passing through. The prostate is going to be the basic, the urinary urethra, vesical urethra, and we have the ejaculatory duct. Okay, so one thing here, what we need to remember is that there is many cases of prostatitis. Prostatitis. Number one, what is the prostate? The prostate is below or under the urinary bladder. This is the urinary bladder. Don't forget the urinary bladder. Below that or under that is the prostatic gland. That can produce prostatitis, means what we call benign prostatic hyperplasia. We are not going to talk about that yet, but prostatitis is an inflammation of the prostate. Please, I want you to pay attention to this. If you have an inflamed prostate, that mostly happens in patients who are elderly, right? So 65, 70 years old, and this prostate starts to get inflamed. You know the five cardinal signs of inflammation, right? Swollen is one. So if this is swollen, the prostate gland is going to constrict what? It's going to constrict peripherally, mechanically, is going to block the exit of urine. So that's why in prostatitis, inflammation of the prostate, people cannot pee. Why? Because the is blocked by the obstruction of the prostate. Okay, perfect. So then we have, I want to go over here, the testicles. The testicles, we have the tunical vaginia. We already talked about that. We talk about the 250 lobes that we have in the testicle. What we have inside is the seminiferous tubules. So seminiferous tubules. These are the seminiferous tubules. We have like three, four of these in each compartment. So here we have the spermatozoids that are going to produce in about 500,000 per day. That is the amount of spermatozoids going to be. And per day, they are going to get immature. They're immature. They don't know what to do yet. So they are going to get into the epididymis. This is the epididymis. In this epididymis, that is going to contain about 1 billion of these spermatozoids. 1 billion. 1 billion. Three times the population of the United States. So three times. So that is actually the epididymis. And the epididymis is located in the superior and posterior portion of the testicle, right? It's the backpack, right, of the testicle. So Here it's going to stay for about 2 to 3 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks. And then they are going to be, during the ejaculation, will go through the epididymis, that this is like a tunnels, a very intricate tunnels, about 50, many, many tunnels. They are going to go into the vas deferens, into the vas deferens. Remember, please, deferens. Or ductus deferens. It's either way, they have the same name. Okay. All right. So, to talking about this, the epididymis, the seminiferous tubules, are the one who produce the spermatozoid, the sperm. The sperm. Sperm is produced by the spermatozoids. Okay. The sperm is produced. The sperm is produced by the seminiferous tubules. Seminiferous tubules. Inside the seminiferous tubules, this is the seminiferous tubules. Inside, we have the spermatozoids that we already mentioned. And on the side, in addition, we have another cell called the Sertoli cell. Sertoli cell. So please get familiar with the name Sertoli cell or sustentacular cell, or called the nerve cells. Nurse cell, because it's taking care of the spermatozoid where in the lumen of the epididymis. Then aside on the around the seminiferous tubules, not inside the seminiferous tubules, but side by lateral or aside from the seminiferous tubules, or in between the seminiferous tubules, we have the Leydig cells, right? The Leydig cells. That is the one who produce the testosterone. Testosterone. Okay, perfect. So that is about the testicle. We have here spermatozoid. The spermatozoid, this is the head. And the head, we have the neck, we have the tail, and the head is going to measure about 5 microns. And that is actually the smallest cell in the body, the spermatozoid. What is the largest and biggest cell in the body is the ovum. So, and the spermatozoid on the head, they're going to have what we call the acrosome. This acrosome is going to contain enzymes. And these enzymes are going to be open when they are touched down the ovum. And literally it's going to drill through the cell membrane of the ovum, and what is going to have is going to release the DNA. We have X in some 50% of the spermatozoids, and 50% of the spermatozoids they have Y. Okay, so they have X or Y. All right. So talking about the pathway of the ejaculation. So you need to remember it's coming from the seminiferous tubules, then go to the epididymis. Then they go to the vas deferens, and then go to the urethra. So that is the way of this. And now, what is semen? Semen is not sperm, because semen is sperm plus the seminal vesical fluid, plus the prostatic fluid, plus the Cooper's gland. Okay? So that is giving you you must remember minimum about these reproductive organs, okay? Finish this part of this meeting, I want just you to remember, let's go back to the ABGs. ABGs. So please, what is the cause of respiratory acidosis? What is the cause of respiratory alkalosis? What is the cause of metabolic acidosis? Metabolic alkalosis. All right. Respiratory acidosis, we have asthma, COPD, bronchiectasis, etc. I'm not going to mention just one, just to be sure that minimum you know this, okay? Minimum. Respiratory alkalosis is going to be panic attacks, metabolic acidosis, especially, please, I want you to remember DKA. DKA is the diabetic keto. Look at this, what I'm going to write. Acidosis. Okay, diabetic ketoacidosis. So how is the body? The body is going to be acidotic. That's why it's acidosis, right? The metabolic, remember when we was talking about metabolic, is about, we're talking about kidneys, right? Kidneys. But when you're talking respiratory, you're talking about lungs. So if the metabolic acidosis is metabolic acidosis, the DKA, how the body is going to compensate, right? If the kidney is the primary problem, who is going to compensate? The lungs. And that means that you have too much acid in your blood. If you have too much acid, that means that you are accumulating too much carbon dioxide. So what is doing the body? The body is trying to eliminate the carbon dioxide during the hyperventilation. So when you have metabolic acidosis, the mechanism of compensation is going to be the hyperventilation. When you have metabolic alkalosis, in the metabolic alkalosis, for example, when you have vomit, so people who have hyperemesis gravidarum or patients who are having vomit because of gastroenteritis, whatever. So what is going to do the body? So if the DKA is going to hyperventilate, metabolic alkalosis is going to produce the hypoventilation. So again, I repeated several times, acidosis, problem, solution, hyperventilation, partial solution, because it's not effective 100% of the time, but alkalosis. In alkalosis, you're going to have the hypoventilation, okay? All right, so I think that's it for today. I want to thank you everyone to come over for this brief, but I guess very substantial review. I'm going to stop recording.